New and expenditure reports of spending entities. United Nations Development Programme turns over specialized court for sexual and gender-based violence cases to the judiciary. World Lebanese Cultural Union donates to the Executive Committee on Coronavirus in Liberia. And elsewhere in Africa, African governments and international institutions carry COVID-19 fight online. These and many other stories are coming up on tonight's edition of the program. Please keep tuned. Welcome back to the program. As the Liberian government grapples with the coronavirus, several local and international organizations continue to render materials and financial support to help eradicate the virus. One of such organizations is the World Lebanese Cultural Union, a non-governmental organization recognized by the Lebanese government to represent Lebanese expatriates or non-residents Lebanese worldwide. On Thursday, the Executive Committee on Coronavirus received a donation of several materials, including 200 bed sheets for hospitals, one refrigerator, two desktop computers, and two grass cutting machines from the organization. Mohamed Matar, a member of the union, made the donation on behalf of the chairman, Ahmed Wazi.
On behalf of the World Lebanese Cultural Union in Liberia, we are pleased with continuous support and commitment to the government of Liberia. We are here today to donate items to help in the fight of COVID-19. And we look forward to working with the government of Liberia when the need arises. Thank you.
Thank you.
The coordinator of the Executive Committee on Coronavirus in Liberia, Madam Mary Burrow, received the items and made these remarks.
We would like to thank the Lebanese culture as their own. I'm quite aware of all the work you're doing. From the ambassador all the way to the citizens, to the business, the Lebanese business community, the culture and everything else, the culture society. We'd like to take this time to thank you for all the work you've done. Now, the first thing you've done so far, apart from Ebola was huge. For you, the Lebanese community, to actually donate for COVID-19, that hospital, unbelievable. First class. When you see the footage, you say, my God. I want to thank you immensely because it can be used for a lot of things. It's well done, high class. And I'd like for you to thank all my Lebanese friends. All my Lebanese friends from way back when they were children.
The pilot project, Max for All and a Sanitation Response, is ongoing to ensure community dwellers ahead to the preventive measures to contain the spread of the coronavirus pandemic in the country. According to Enfield Director General Dr. Musoka Fala, just about 15% of the population in those communities wear masks, one of the measures to prevent the spread of COVID-19.
The city will do a legal agreement to ensure that whatever they sell from the masks is kept with that community to help them to support the hand washing station. We also will supply the masks from the tailors to give it to the institute the community will sell. In cases where the tailor don't have the means to sew, because lack of funding, will give them seed money as an entity so they can produce the masks, we take the masks and give it to the community. Our job will be to find funding internally and externally. Like I said, we'll be able to monitor the project, to be able to supervise the soul making, vision making soap. And we ensure that we work with the local marks. We intend to produce around 10,000 flyers for businesses to look at no mask, no service. It has been shown in China and many parts of Europe that where they enforce no mask, no service in shops, in stores, in supermarket, people are adhering to mask wearing. We'll produce the masks, we'll produce the posters and stuff to share, put around hospitals, shops around the community, and the local government and tax force will then make sure that those shops sell to people who have masks. That's our goal. And then again, like we said, since we're a research institute, we look at research and look at the effect. We expect the community to identify their tailor and seamstress which they have done. We expect them to be able to make sure that they produce the masks on time. We expect the community to ensure that they are able to enforce the no mask, no service stickers. And then ensure that the community adhere to the rules. Because they can't complain now and say, oh, we don't have a mask. Because we are going to produce that. And then we will provide education for the people that they will in turn educate their people on how to properly use the masks. Because somebody will use one mask for 2-3 days. Instead of taking away the disease, it brings disease. And then the community will be trying to sell a mask. We didn't want to give it for free. The agreement we had was that we should be giving for the lowest price, like $20 or $25, and that money come back to the community. And they will manage the funds that will come to be able to help the boys at the station.
The Liberian government has commenced the regular publication of revenue and expenditure reports of various spending entities. The initiative is part of efforts to enhance government's commitment to transparency and accountability. A release said under the new measure, the Ministry of Finance and Development Planning will post weekly fiscal reports on its website for public consumption. The report's tag, that's title, Fiscal Data Transparency Measure, will reflect budget performances of each entities, and that the report was published on May 24 this year in continuation of the government's Open Budget and Fiscal Transparency Initiative. Meanwhile, the Ministry of Finance has also begun implementing a newly designed cash management system, which has effectively addressed the issue of cash shortage in the country. The release also said these allotments will now be approved under the new scheme based on the availability of cash. The Organization for Women Empowerment has donated non-food items to female inmates at the Monrovia Central Prison. Making the presentation, the group advocacy and a training officer, Arita Togba, said the items will help with the upkeep of the women in prison.
Here again, we say we have two programs under the Organization for Women Empowerment that we run. We have the Women Economic Empowerment Program, of which we are also here, and we also have the Girls Education and Support Program. Under the Women Economic Empowerment Program, we empower women who are also engaged in small businesses, and we provide small loans for them and see how they can augment their living standard. We have been doing that since 2016. We have been in this for a long time now. And also we have our girls program that we run in various schools. We got scholarship and also financial aid that we provide for girls from 5 different schools. And also we are also having girls livelihood skills and all of that with girls also. And so today we are here, you know, to supply, you know, these small items. We have sanitary pad, we got sanitizer, we got alcohol and tissue, just to identify with them, because we are here so much for the underserved women. And so the prisoners who have been left outside, and many people may not think about them, but always is our goal, and you know, to think about people like the inmates in this compound. And that's why we are here this morning
receiving the items Monrovia Central Prison Deputy Superintendent Joel Joa thanked the group for the donation, noting that women's needs are human rights.
On behalf of the Honorable Minister, Assistant Minister for the Bureau of Corrections and Rehabilitation, Honorable Eddie Tuawade, and the Honorable Superintendent Vani G. Legu, who would have loved to be here in order to receive you people. But due to some busy schedule, you asked me to proceed on behalf of those people. I want to say thank you for this gift. Like we always say, women needs, they are human rights needs. So whatever they form themselves, behave biamba, behave aksa, their needs cannot be underestimated or overemphasized. And so to see these organizations coming to the facility to buttress the effort of government in terms of donations for our female inmates, I see it as applause. And so let me congratulate all of you for coming to the facility. And I can assure you that this action will be news for the intended purpose.
Well, in case you're just joining us, this is a reminder that you're watching LNTV News Live, 30-minute production of the television department here at the Liberia Broadcasting System. My name is Amanda Yasir Saleh, anchoring tonight's edition of the program. And these are the top stories we are following. The African Union, AU, has started an ambitious increased testing for coronavirus across the continent. The Liberian government begins a regular publication of revenue and expenditure reports of spending entities. United Nations Development Programme turns over specialized court for sexual and gender-based violence cases to the judiciary. World Lebanese Cultural Union donates to the Executive Committee on Coronavirus in Liberia. Well, these are the top stories we are following, and many other stories still coming up on tonight's edition. Don't go away. Let's take a short break. To be right back. Welcome back to the program. A former employee of the Liberia Broadcasting System, LBS, in the United States, Pee Wee Besa, has identified with the system. Mr. Besa on Thursday presented 5 bags of 25 kilograms of rice, 5 3 gallons of cooking oil, and 150 nose masks. The items were presented to the management of the Liberia Broadcasting System by the union's president, Moses Dobo, on behalf of Mr. Besa.
Good are all of us here, Mr. Director General, Madam Deputy of Administration. I'm here today, happy, but of course representing my little brother, Pee Wee Kova Besa, and his wife, Bindu Besa. They are all in the United States. Besa, of course, is a former employee of the Liberia Broadcasting System. He worked in both television, worked in radio, and worked in news. So he called me the other time and told me that he wanted to do something of this nature, a little donation. So he has presented to me this morning, through our sister and the brother, 15 bags of rice and 5 can of argo oil, which he think that can be used by the employees of this institution in this emergency period. So I'm happy on behalf of the Besa family in the United States and those that are here. I'm not too sure Besa has any political intention official political intention to be anybody, but he thinks that his alma mater is this, and he knows everyone here. He has associated with everyone here. He thinks that there's a time that he should identify with the employees of this institution. So, without much to do to say, Mr. Director General, Madam Deputy, 15 bags of rice and 5 or tin of argo oil, including 150 marks. The only reason you can't see that now is I supposed to pick it up, but it was not ready. I'm sure before the end of the day, I will pick it up and I will deliver it to you, 150 pieces of marks.
Receiving the items, LBS Director General Lekjahold Reni thanked Mr. Piwi Besa for the gesture.
Besa is one of such former employees of LBS who has always been in touch with LBS. He calls regularly, he checks on the workers, his friends who he left here. He calls us as managers to find out what we're doing and how he can be of help. And so, I'm not surprised that he's done this, especially during this emergency period and critical time of our country and the world, so to speak. It shows that he's a family man, he's a brother and a friend. Things are hard all over the world, and to take his personal resources and to make these things to his fellow brothers here at LBS, sisters and brothers at LBS, is quite commendable. I say surprised because, you know, most of the time, the people who make the loudest of noise, or noises, so to speak, are those who don't do nothing. And Beza is not a person who talks a lot, but he's an action man, and it tells from his gesture towards us. And so we're happy. The workers will continue to do their duty as workers of LBS, especially during these trying and challenging times. We're here as a management to encourage them to continue to work sacrificially. There are a lot of good news in the area for LBS. I don't want to say that now here publicly, but it's encouraging that especially the general public which we serve, you know, has been so kind to us in terms of, you know the positive things that they say about the station and its employees and how we carry on our duty. So we'd like to thank them and thank Besa and his family, and thank you all for this. This will go a long way in helping us to continue to provide the little that we do on a daily basis to encourage our staff to continue their sacrificial services to LBS during this emergency period. So let me through you, Mr. President of the Workers Union, convey to Mr. Besa and his family in the U.S. our profound thanks and appreciation. Thank you.
And away from Liberia, the African Union, AU, has started an ambitious initiative to increase testing for coronavirus across the country. That's the continent. The aim is to take the total number of tests done up to 10 million over the next 2 to 3 months. To date, more than 160,000 cases have been confirmed in Africa, with 4,600 deaths. But experts fear many cases could be going undetected because of low testing rates, which are some of the lowest globally. The Africa Centers for Disease Control and Prevention says about 2.4 million tests have been conducted so far. But they now want to reach 3 times as many people again in the coming weeks. Many, almost 1% of people in Africa, will have been tested. Well, that's how I would like to leave you on tonight's edition of the program. But just before we go, these are the top stories we have been following on tonight's presentation. The Liberian government begins regular publication of revenue and expenditure reports of spending entities. United Nations Development Programme turns over specialized court for sexual and gender-based violence cases to the judiciary. World Lebanese Cultural Union donates to the Executive Committee on Coronavirus in Liberia and elsewhere in Africa. Governments and international institutions carried COVID-19 fight online. Well, on behalf of the entire team here from the Liberia Broadcasting System, I'd like to say many thanks to you for being a part of this program, and thanks to Top TV in Zuwaju City, Grangide County, for relaying our program. Thanks so much, and do have a pleasant night.
National Toiletries Incorporated, Liberia-owned and reliable toiletries company, specialized in advanced quality toiletries assorted products such as Kuma tissue, Kuma baby pimples, Kuma napkins, Kuma paper towel, and Kuma flora. At National Toiletries Incorporated, we also have Gulf LC and UP cosmetic products. We have the expertise and experience. We train professional Liberian men and women. We use modernized machines and equipment to produce international standard toiletries in Liberia. We also produce Kuma Bimu special mineral water, Mamu Sucre gel, and laundry soap. National Toiletries Incorporated, Liberia-owned toiletries. We are located in Pinesville, Bena Farm. Call us on the following numbers: 0775-543-985, 0770-60079, 0886-543-985, or 0770-535-114. Whenever you think about the best toiletries in Liberia, think National Toiletries Incorporated, where every customer is our priority.
Naresh Brothers, retailer in consumer electronics, home and office furniture, located on Randall Street, Broad Street, Red Light, Waterside, and 15th Street Sinker, are the sole distributor of Afstron, Adi, H2O, TCL, and so many best brands around the world. Naresh Brothers also have a wide range of home appliances, including freezers, washing machines, air conditioners, and the first ever rechargeable flat screen TV in Liberia. Yes, at Naresh Brothers, we have cell phones, stereo sets, mixers, and amplifiers for any occasion. And that's not all. At Naresh Brothers, you can find the best quality home furniture, dining room sets, executive office set, and conference room table. We also offer warranty and after sales service on our products. For more information, please call cell numbers 0881-629-110 or 0770-681-852 or 0777-622-666. You can also follow us on the following social media platforms like our Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and Twitter pages.
Hello, Mom.
How are you?
I'm fine, thank you. How's Dad?
Your dad is fine. Are you okay? You have not sent me the money you promised.
I'm so sorry, Mama. I'm going to do it today.
Send it now before you forget again.
Okay, no problems. I'll do it now. Check.
Are you sure?
Yes, so, and I also paid for your cable, and I'm sending you credit for this long call you're making right now.
Thank you, my son. God bless you.
All right, Mama, I love you so much, yeah? I'll speak to you later.
When you drop, everybody know they tire. All of the girls go do anything for my love. All of the boys go do anything for the money. Then they dance to my music and they show me love. Girls wanna touch, wanna love, they want the love. Yeah, I got one life, make a leave.
Introducing Royal Butter Bread. Delicious, nutritious, ideal for your health and vitality. Carefully prepared on hygienic conditions. A Royal Butter Bread is bromide free, lasting longer than any other bread. Royal Butter Bread is produced by Hope Bakery Liberia Incorporated, producer of the best family choices in town. The Royal Butter Slice Bread, Royal Butter Round Bread, Royal Wheat Bread, and you name it, Hope Bakery Liberia Incorporated is located on AB Tubble Road in Pinsville. For wholesale supply, contact them on 0775-522-030 or 0880-343-873. Hope Bakery Liberia Incorporated, the King Bread Maker.
Yeah, baby. Last thing I bought was that show and I can see you.
Oh, man, Jaro.
What we say, well, let me let the problem we are facing now, now, a family issue. Hey, my woman, bitterly, get problem now with me. Eh? Anything where I do, I drink the atai, I eat the bitter cola, I do all that one. Still, he telling me, say, I'm not able to do the one. What's the one for silly I do now? Eh?
You ever try master judging before?
Now, the solution for my problem here,
try master judging. Your woman will follow you everywhere you go.
That one we talk, I know, say, see, get happen, but I want to see you, my pussy, abo.
Hey, Come to the play.
The one? Naha Class Master Dry Gin, the original. Now only one sip at I'm feeling like master already.
Master Dry Gin, proudly produced and marketed by International Best Industries IBI on the Monrovia Freeway and available all over Liberia.
Honey, our guests are on the way for the party, and I'm so worried about the best kind of drinks to offer our guests.
Sweetheart, is that why you are worried and even stressing yourself? When the greatest man of all drinks is here.
And who is that?
The man that comes with high class.
Wow, you are the man, the master of the house. This is what makes you a high-class master.
Master Dry Jingle is served to your high-class friends, loved ones, and family members. So, with Master Dry Jingle, you are also my big Jew.
Bigger is better. The 750-milliliter Master Dry Gin is produced and marketed by International Best Industries IBI on the Monrovia Freeway.
I found a love for me, darling, just dive right in, follow my lead.
Wow, you are all beautiful. Welcome to the VIP's table. What can I offer you guys?
VIP vodka.
You got it.
You can say that again.
Cause we were just kids when we fell in.
Oh, wait.
Oh my God, I can't wait anymore.
Let's cheers to VIP Vodka, the best energy plus. VIP Vodka.
VIP Vodka is the best.
VIP Vodka, produced and marketed by International Best Industries IBI on the Monrovia Freeway, is now available all over Liberia.
No need to ask, he's a smooth operator.
I
same and bold. You really know how to operate, oh.
Still feeling fine from last night?
I tell you.
Girl, that's why they call me the smooth operator.
I know.
So, can we get together later?
Can we say sooner?
Why not? Smooth
operator. Operate with Godfather Fine Whiskey, Godfather Fine Brandy, and Godfather Fine Gin. Produced by International Best Industries IBI on the freeway and available all over Liberia.
Protect our communities. Unity in action saves lives. Organizations and partners can work together to combine and coordinate COVID-19 efforts. This message is brought to you by UNDP. In partnership with the government of Liberia.
Hello. Hello, everyone. We know all that the situation with the coronavirus is a very serious one, and we need to put health first. There are five key tactics to tackle the coronavirus, and I urge you all to follow with discipline at all times with five key tactics.
Todo comienza con tus manos. Por favor, lávate las manos frecuentemente y si es posible, con una solución de alcohol.
With your elbows bent, please cover your nose and mouth if you sneeze or cough. If using tissues, dispose of them immediately.
Pour le visage, évitez de toucher les yeux, le nez et la bouche. Cela va empêcher le virus de rentrer dans votre organisme.
In terms of social interaction, take a step back. Stay 1 meter distance minimum from everyone that coughs or sneezes.
If you feel unwell, stay home. In some countries, isolation might be advisable for healthy persons too. Please follow all instructions from your local health authority.
So please keep yourself informed at all times, follow these recommendations, and support the WHO in their efforts to tackle coronavirus. Together, we will win this difficult match.
The coronavirus pandemic has changed life as we know it. Given that it's not just a passing cloud, it's no longer a question of what will, but what does the new normal look like? We've transitioned into a world where almost everything is done remotely. So how is technology redefining our society? And is this crisis grooming us for life online? This is The Breakdown, BBC Africa's COVID-19 special program, helping you make sense of the crisis. My name is Sharon Mashira. Now, new rules of work, travel, and socialization are being rewritten across the world in what has come to be known as the new normal. The human race has been forced to adapt in order to survive. The global economy is in turmoil as we wade through the unknown. The question on everyone's mind is, where do we go from here? Let's start with aviation. To remain in the skies with passengers on board, airlines will have to adhere to strict protocols to avoid further spread of the virus. A Kenya Airways flight evacuating Kenyans stuck in India where they had gone to seek treatment early this month gives us a peek into what seems to be the future of flying. Social distancing remains a key requirement and crews are practicing no-touch techniques when serving passengers. This means that crew have no contact with passengers' luggage at any point. And the charming smiles of air hostesses are now covered in layers of protective gear. In short, planes will accommodate less passengers, and this will result to flying being too expensive for many to afford. But let's get off board and see how life has changed in places where governments have eased movement restrictions after weeks of lockdown.
It is the new normal for Ghanaians to wear masks, wash hands regularly, and keep social distance. In a deeply social society, this comes as a huge challenge. But to remain operational, businesses have to ensure their staff and clients strictly follow these measures. I went to the street of Accra to find out how Ghanaians are adjusting to the new normal.
At first, it was very difficult. We don't even get a car to take to this place. We find it difficult coming to town and those things, but now we move freely.
People need to work. If you look at our working sector, for instance, a lot of us work in the informal sector. So a lot of people will be agitating to go to work to make ends meet. And it's happening all around the world. People are lifting a lockdown. So I think we just have to adhere to the social distancing rules and go about our daily activities.
I can tell that the adjustment is being done well. Nobody is treating it as if they've been forced to. The people that I interact with, those that I see, are deliberately making the situation work. That's what you can tell. Like, I observe them and I can tell that they're adjusting smoothly.
In Senegal, the government has been facing pressure to balance public health with economic and social local realities in the face of COVID-19. On 11th of May, the Senegalese president, Macky Sall, announced several measures to ease the curfew and the current restrictions put in place to fight the spread of the virus. In his speech to the nation, the president shortened curfew hours to 9 p.m. to 5 a.m. from the current 8 p.m. to 6 a.m., while the office hours will be from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. He allowed markets and other businesses to resume their normal opening hours 6 days a week from 3 days per week. However, the markets will close businesses once per week for sanitization. Regarding schools, Macky Sall reaffirmed the resumption of classes on June the 2nd for graduating classes, which consist of about 551,000 students across Senegal. 10 million masks made in Senegal will be distributed in schools, places of worship, markets and public transports. The Senegalese president also commended those who fight the pandemic with positive initiatives and innovations such as the production of masks, the students and the scientists who produced antiseptic gels, created robots, ventilators and hand washing machines, the engineers building e-commerce platforms. But he also commended the delivery businesses offering their services so that people can avoid unnecessary movement, putting themselves at risk of contamination.
A key point to note is that lifting of lockdowns in countries doesn't mean going back to our old ways of living. Social distancing and other protective measures put in place by governments, like wearing of face masks, will still need to be observed. The justice system has been an early adapter to technology. Who would have thought a time would come when justice would be dispensed remotely? A court in Nigeria sentenced a man to death in a virtual ruling during the 5 week of the country's coronavirus lockdown in Lagos. The judge ordered death by hanging for Olalaken Hamid, a driver, over the murder of his boss's mother. But as Hamid awaits his execution, he joins a troubled community of inmates that are in a state of fear over the crowding that characterizes prisons in many African countries. In Kinshasa's Ndola military prison in the Democratic Republic of Congo, more than 100 inmates are reported to have been infected with the novel coronavirus as at the beginning of the month of May. Ethiopia released 4,000 inmates back in March in an effort to prevent the spread of the virus in her correctional facilities.
First respondent.
Kenya also released about 5,000 petty offenders and those who were almost finishing their sentences through a Skype courtroom session. Virtual justice aside, digital transformation has become a matter of survival, especially for companies and businesses. Those that are less tech savvy are now in a rush to establish their digital presence.
We saw how successful digital transformation was. So many organizations increased the number of their clients. They were able to access clients that they were not able to access before. Some of them even modified their services so they can able to provide other services.
But cybersecurity threats, which existed before COVID-19, could be on the rise due to increased remote working. So how can people and companies ensure their privacy and data protection?
the organizations review constantly their systems, their security systems, and their security infrastructure, and they are always enhancing it. And we see all our clients are doing that, and they don't do this even at long intervals. They do this at short intervals. And the security products and offerings and services that, for example, in our company we're offering, they provide the highest level of security.
Kenya is one of the countries on the continent that's employing a digital solution to the public health emergency, a solution that must navigate through the restrictive data protection environment for it to be foolproof.
What Jitenge does is that it allows you to self-report, and that also limits the time that you and maybe the healthcare workers get to interact, and which also keeps the person who is on quarantine safe. We work closely with the Ministry of Health to make sure that we have proper security, and even the redundancies that we create within the data is protected, and working very closely with the Ministry of Health.
Let's look at how technology is impacting yet another essential service, journalism. Solomon Mugera is the head of journalism at BBC Africa. So Solomon, with 20,000 strong workforce across the world, how is the BBC coping with this disruptive pandemic?
A few of us have been working from home, but then you have a situation where now masses of people hate to work from home. What does that mean? It means having the necessary facilities to help you to do exactly that. You need a laptop, or you need an iPad, you need an iPhone, you need internet, you need a desk, you need a chair. So all those things were thrown at us. But more important was to think, can we guarantee the safety of our employees, of our staff, at the same time maintaining production of news and current affairs? Because if I'm sitting at home and I've got my iPhone and I'm doing something for radio, or I'm doing something for TV, I'm doing something for social media, and I use my smartphone, I take a video, I take sound, then I can quickly edit that if it's a very good phone. And then after that, have enough bundles to transmit the same to somebody now who is sitting in the studio, to cobble things together, compile them into something coherent, and then distribute as a nice bulletin or a nice program like the breakdown that you are doing right now.
All right, Solomon, just quickly before we leave you, what's it been like for you? You're running teams across the whole continent from London. How has this experience been like for you?
It's been tough because, number one, I want us to continue to serve our audiences with the quality information, reliable information, and making sure that we are gathering that information in a safe way. We can't gather the way we used to gather. We can't send teams out into the field the way we used to. So what majority of our reporters and producers are doing is to contact people. In any case, what is journalism? What is storytelling? It's about people. So having contacts, they enable you to get stories from those people in those locations, sharing with you their experiences. What are they going through? And then reaching out to people who are in authority, telling you and explaining things, why they're taking the decisions they're taking, explaining those policies, reaching to people who can analyze and explain things to us. And we are doing that from the comfort of our chairs, taking a phone, calling and recording, and then getting those remarks and comments and analysis on air or publishing them on websites. So for me, it's been a matter of thinking, how do I enable our teams to do this? I'm working with a team of senior editors and program editors and service editors, and everybody in BBC Africa is a very hardworking team, and people are going an extra mile to make sure they're using the resources at their disposal to serve our audiences.
Right. Well, thank you so much, Solomon. It was lovely catching up. So it's time to take a short break. But when we come back, we'll further explore life online as the global crisis continues to push us into a digital world. Do stay with us.
Thank you.
This is The Breakdown, BBC Africa's COVID-19 special program, helping you make sense of the crisis. Across the world, millions of us are now connecting to the internet from our kitchens, living rooms, and home offices every single day as more aspects of our lives move online due to the pandemic. Well, besides seeking new ways of connecting, operations and services are moving online to limit physical interaction. Microsoft CEO Satya Nadella says that we've seen 2 years' worth of digital transformation happen in just 2 months, but not everyone can afford the transition to a digital world yet, especially the older generation.
Let me try call my mom and see what she's up to right now.
Hi, Ian.
How are you doing today?
It would be better if you're here.
Yeah, I know. I would have loved to be with you as well. So, mom, so how different do you think it is for your generation and my generation when it comes to the use of technology? What is it you see that makes you see a difference?
It's so huge. It's a lot. Just give you an example. It may not be work-related, but there's a group of ladies, about 15 of us, and we're just about to have our quarterly meeting. And so one of us who is tech savvy said, oh, we shall go on Zoom. And one of us said, sasa hiyo Zoom inafanywa namna gani, tutafanya aje? And she just really panicked genuinely.
Have you heard about WhatsApp University for Moms?
No, not yet. Tell me about it.
Mothers are being accused of, sending information, a lot of kind of scary information, and some of it is not necessarily true.
Yeah. I'm sure, Ian, you know that I would graduate there very soon, because at one point you had to tell me to just back up a little and verify with you, or just look at what sources it's coming from. So, yeah, I'm a victim of that.
I didn't tell you the tips that you should watch out for to make sure that whatever you're sharing to us and even the entire family, that it's actually accurate.
The first thing you do, you look at the source. So who's the author of the information, and is the source credible? Number two, verify the information. Check whether other outlets have reported on the same. Number three, if it's a link you've been sent for, does the website have more details like how to contact the authors? On number four, always look for typing errors or poor grammatical sentence construction. And then number five, read beyond the headlines. If it's too good to be true, then don't believe it. And then number six, ask experts. Basically, fact-checking organizations like Africa Check or a journalist like myself, and those should be able to help you.
Okay, bye, Mama. Leave you there.
Yes, bye-bye.
Stay safe and stay home.
Well, stay home, stay safe has become one of the most popular phrases spoken and written everywhere. But what are we doing while at home? For some, there's too much time with so little to do. For others, they're getting paid to pass time.
Data from game developers Newzoo shows that players are now using this time when they're at home to make money, escape from reality, and social connection. A survey was conducted of gamers between the age of 10 and 30. Nearly half of them said now they have more time to play. Almost all of them attributed the increase in playtime to the coronavirus outbreak. There are over 2.5 billion gamers in the world. This should tell you just how big the industry is.
Gaming is much bigger than movies, music combined.
And now there's something called esports, a series of online competitions.
The opportunity that has opened up is people focusing more on their online content in terms of streaming and just general content creation.
Queen Arrow is one of Africa's top gamers. Gamers don't reveal their real names. But fun fact about her, she's a lawyer by day and a gamer by night.
Yes, you can make a living from being a professional gamer, because it's not just the salary that comes from your team. There's also endorsement deals and being the face of a brand. First of all, you'll say that there's a game you love to specialize in. It's not easy. Work hard, play hard. That's how the game goes. Pun intended.
Remember what I talked about sponsorships and endorsements? Well, Queen Arrow has now been signed up by Brutal Democracy Esports, based in the UK. Who actually makes these games? We take an example of one of the world's largest online game sellers, Steam. A Forbes report showed that 80% of the games that Steam released made just about $5,000 in only the first 2 weeks when they were released.
Currently, there is more money being made by people making games. Starting with the games, then going into animation, consumer products, and actually Angry Birds became the fastest growing consumer brand ever.
The challenges we've faced is finding the solution to making this a sustainable business. You can be a web designer, you can be a tournament organizer, you can be a shoutcaster, you can be the gamer, you can design the websites.
Whether you're looking for ways to handle anxiety, make money, or just pass some time, this is one of the ways to do it. Right, you guys now have to go. I have some challenges and some games to complete.
Besides playing and, well, making money while at it for those who can, many are getting hooked online. But whether working, networking, or shopping for essentials, psychologists worry that the excess presence online may be turning into a dangerous addiction. Shopping has been made easy online. Just one click and your shopping experience at a luxury store begins, or you find yourself at a clearance sale with tempting offers for things you don't need. Are we losing control of ourselves on impulse buying? How best can we manage our time and money and lifestyle online?
Picture this. You cannot leave your house. You binge through almost everything there is to see on TV, and your eyes cannot bear another page of a book.
That's what I would have said if everything was business as usual. But now I don't have to, as we are all living it, life and a lockdown.
Thanks to technology, a lot of us have found comfort online. It is the closest we have to human contact, but also online shops.
I love shopping, and I love to shop online.
I love shopping. Currently working from home. But since the lockdown started, I find myself online a lot more.
Especially at this time when we have the COVID-19 pandemic, and we basically have to stay home. What better thing to do than to go online, check the catalogs, what's on style, what is cheap, order, pay for it with credit card, and have it delivered right to my doorstep. How convenient.
I get so many adverts coming my way, and I just can't stop buying. I happen to buy things that I don't even need.
There was once this time that I saw a pair of bunny ears, and I thought, well, it looks nice. So I bought it, and after it got here, I kept asking myself, where am I going to wear this to?
I find it easy, but it's becoming too expensive because I'm overspending.
It's not entirely our fault that online shopping has gotten so out of hand. Retailers make it effortless to browse and add a few impulse buys to our carts and spend more than we planned. They promise free shipping, show us related products or accessories on a sidebar, and tempt us to spend more with coupon codes. Even when you're not on an e-commerce site, dozens of flashy ads from sites you've already visited try tempting you to return.
But how would you know that you've crossed the line?